Good morning. I welcome you on this Memorial Day weekend Sunday worship, and we do wish to pay tribute to the recognition of Armed Forces Day, which is the 21st, and that will be part of our prayer. And we pray for our nation this morning, especially on Memorial Day. We honor those who made the ultimate sacrifice. And this points us to Jesus, who says, there is no greater love than the one who would lay down their life. And God in Jesus laid down his life for you and for me. And that's why we're here. And so we're here this morning answering God's call to worship, to thank God for his marvelous gift. So I invite you to stand with me now. We're going to sing our opening song of praise and worship. It's a favorite, one of the all-time favorite hymns called Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Hallelujah. Praise God for his faith. Let's give God an offering of praise. And we appreciate the response in our hearts when we lift our praises to God. And we just want to continue now, again, with another patriotic song, America, the Beautiful. This next song is a beautiful melody that you may recognize, but with words of praise and words of prayer. And we're going to play the verse for you to hear the melody. And during the introduction of this song, I invite you to enter into an attitude of prayer. Our theme this morning, having to do with the message of loving where we live. And this morning, the focus on 2 Corinthians in chapter 5 has to do with what it means to be in Christ and for Christ to be in us and the goal of being new creation people, which has to do with revival, has to do with renewal of our lives, personal, individual lives, the life of our church, our community, our nation, and the world, that God's righteousness would rain down upon us through his marvelous gift of love. Thank you. praise you, Jesus, God's Son within. We praise you, Spirit, our all in all. We praise and worship. This is our call. Your gift of love is strong. Your grace in all you do, do your forgiveness of all our sin. This is our prayer. Revive us again. Oh, hallelujah. Our King. Oh, hallelujah, to you we seek, into your glory we rise above, to you we sing, our gift of praise you, Father, my God in heaven. I praise you, Jesus, God's Son within. I praise you, Spirit, my all in all. I praise and worship. This is my call. Your gift of love is strong and true. I see your grace in all you do. Through your forgiveness of all my sin, this is my prayer. Again. Oh, hallelujah to Christ my King. Oh, hallelujah to you I see. Into your glory I rise above. To bow with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we bow to you with thanksgiving and praise. We desire to worship you in holiness according to your call upon our lives. And we ask now that we would be sure about forgiveness, that we could be just completely convinced that if we confess and when we confess, you will keep your promise and you will forgive us for all of it. So let us be sure about our confession now as we pour out our hearts to you, that you would wash away all clutter, all distraction, all the noise of the world. Quiet our hearts now as we pray and give you thanks. We worship you, we praise you, we want you more and more. You've done it all, you've given it all for us. Help us to open ourselves to receive you more and more. Help us to grow in our faith. Help us to increase in hope. And most of all, Lord, let us experience more of your love, that we can fulfill the command to love you with all of our heart and soul and mind and strength, and that we could love others as you have loved us, and that you can teach us better how to love our neighbors. Lord, we thank you for those who answer the call to serve our nation in the military. We want to lift up these who are related to our church family. Cord Bouchot, Jordan Choate, Kyla Davis, Drew Derude, Hank Hagen, Madison Melcher, Monty Langford, Seth Mickelson, David Rybach, David Stroda, Ryan Van Endy, and Stephen Wolf. Bless them today, and bless all who serve. And Lord, on this weekend, we especially pay tribute to those who gave their lives fighting for our freedom. And it points us to you, Jesus, for what you have said, recorded in John chapter 15, that greater love has no person than the one who would lay down their lives for their friends. So thank you, Jesus, for your great gift. Thank you for this worship this morning, for all who have answered the call of ministry here in Waseca and here at Christ Community Church, and for missionaries around the world. And we especially lift up Brian and Carrie Surrett and ask that you would bless them and increase our prayer support to them and all of our missionaries, along as the monetary support that helps them to continue in their ministry. And we pray for missionary Jerry Krause to continue to bless him and bless the family. Give us the perseverance in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, we lift up Pastor Rick to you. We thank you that he has answered your call that brought him here to Waseca, and the call that has launched him into the lead pastor role. And we want to bless him in your name. And we ask that you bless him fully. And wherever he is, Lord, take him to a new level of anointing. Let him receive you more and more. He hungers for you. He is here to serve you. He's passionate about you. So let your love be poured into him in such a way that our lives be touched through today's message. In Jesus' name we pray, and all the people say amen.
Hello, my name is Annie. I am from Austin, Texas. I work for Christ Together Greater Austin, and I help with events, social media, and kind of all hands on deck. My neighboring story happened one afternoon while I was working from home, but when I first moved in, I met one of my neighbors who we parked next to each other, and it was a super brief interaction. We exchanged names, but I didn't think that he would be very relevant in my life, so it kind of went in one ear and out the other. So after meeting him, really, we had very little interaction except smelling his pot through the walls every now and again. And other than that, I didn't think much of him, which is sad. But one afternoon, I pulled in after coming back from a meeting, and I was working in my apartment and watching TV, answering emails, taking phone calls, and I heard like people running up the back stairs, heard them banging on a door, and so I turned the TV off and started listening, and after a while, the door finally opened and he answered the door, and I heard the cop say, "It's APD, we're here for crisis intervention." I believe he called his mom, and then the mom called APD, but he was going to take his life. He'd been going to, I think, like a counselor or something, and that they'd prescribed him stuff, but that the drugs were only making suicidal thoughts worse. They asked him why he like made the claim to take his life, and he said because he was depressed. And really, the conversation kind of went from there, and I didn't get to hear the end of the conversation. I heard them talk about taking him and to him get help and, you know, going to a treatment facility or something like that, but I don't really know how the conversation ended. I heard them leave, and then really after that, his car was gone for like really 2 months, until like literally like last week or so. There was a moving truck outside. His car was back for like an hour and a half, and I haven't seen him since. I think the realization I've had after that is that, you know, we can't always assume that there's a tomorrow, and something as important as knowing the people that live around you can't always be put off till tomorrow. Because in that moment when I started to pray for him, it just hit me so hard that I didn't even remember his name, because I didn't think to remember his name. And I'd had the mindset moving in here that this would be, you know, not permanent, that once I, you know, got married and had my own house, then I would get to know those neighbors once I was, like, settled. I think I just realized that we are where we are right now for a very specific purpose, and that you really never know what's going on around you, and for such darkness to be literally right down the hall was just heartbreaking. So it might be easier for all of you to watch me tell my story and see my journey and kind of point the finger, but I think that the reality of it is that there's a lot of people that are in my same spot, because we never really know what our neighbors are going through and what's going on around us if we don't take that first step. So I decided to share my story with you because I wanted to encourage you to take that step and get to know your neighbors and to truly love where you live. Hello, my name is Annie, and my story is not ending. It's just beginning.
I want to tell you a story about a woman named Esther. Esther lives in a care facility here in Waseca. I got a phone call from a attender of our church asking if I would go and visit Esther. This person had conversations along the way at work, and she was interested in knowing more about Jesus. And so I made an arrangement and visited with Esther and knocked on the door. And I walk in and she is sitting there reading an Our Daily Bread. I can figure out where she got that Our Daily Bread from. And so I'm like, this is a good sign. I sit down and ask her, would you just tell me a little bit about yourself? And her very first thing was, I've been an atheist most of my life. How do you start a conversation with somebody who's been an atheist much of her life? As we sat down, and it was about an hour conversation with her, and come to find out, she really hasn't been an atheist. She really has believed in God her entire life. She had some struggles with organized religion. There were some churches that didn't treat her very well. And so she had turned herself off to a relationship with God because of religion. And so I'm sitting there and hearing her story and talking and realized that God had been priming this pump for a long time. In fact, I think that she had already come to faith in Christ, and all I had to do was say, Esther, do you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord? And she says, yes, I do. And do you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead for you? And she says, yes, I believe. I said, Esther, then you're saved. And so she got this big old grin on her face. I said, Esther, what's next for you? What can we do for you? What can our church do for you? I said, do you have a Bible? And she said, no, I don't have a Bible. I said, can I buy you a Bible? And she said, I would love a Bible. So I kind of asked around if anybody had a giant print Bible, because she's 92. And I ended up going online, finding one, shipped 2 days, fantastic. I brought it to her. And it's because this other person, this church attender, said, I want to love where I live. And we've been kind of taking this idea of love where you live, and we've been saying it's our house, our physical location, our address, our neighborhoods. where we live. But realistically, loving where we live is about loving where God has made us alive. We work here. We go to school here. We have friends here. We go out to eat here. We live here. This is our home. It's not just our house. It's where we live. And this person said, God, I want you to use me. And so she would leave Bible verses on her door. She would leave notes of encouragement, had conversations with Esther. And God was gracious. And Esther became a new creation in Christ. And that's what we celebrate. We celebrate new creations in Christ. We celebrate people saying, I want to love where I live. And God, I just want you to use me for your purpose. And when God does that, sons and daughters are born into God's family. How exciting is that? Amen. My name is Rick, and it's my privilege to be one of the pastors here, to open God's word with you, to be a part of this church family together. And if you are a first-time guest with us, thank you for being here as well. I know we've got some family and some family friends in for the holiday weekend. Happy Memorial Day, and we are glad that you are here. And we are in the middle of this series, Love Where You Live. And the big idea of the series is, what if God has a purpose for placing us where we live? And we started out on Mother's Day, and then we kind of got into this series and said that if loving where we live begins with loving where we live. And we don't always love where we live, but we need to realize that that's where it starts. And then we get to discover God's purpose that he has for us. And he's placed us here and now in this plot of land, whether it's Waseca or Waterville or Janesville or New Richland or states across the country. And God has said, this is your time. This is your purpose. And we're here for a reason. And as we think about the gospel and sharing the gospel, loving where we live strengthens us to live out transformed lives. If you're taking notes, that's the blank on there. And we're going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We encourage you to open your Bibles. We invite you to open your Bible apps. Open the Bible in front of you. It's going to be page 818 in the Bible in front of you. We're going to be in the ESV version. Slightly different than what would be in your pew Bible, but it should read similar enough that you can follow along. And we're going to jump right in today. So here we go. Here is 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul writes this. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. And all of this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the message of ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. And so, Jesus, we celebrate and thank you that you have done all the work for us. That because of the cross and the empty tomb, that we get to celebrate this message of reconciliation, being made right with God. And all of those who have called on you to be saved are new creations. God, that is so incredible. We thank you. We thank you for this church family that we get to celebrate this ministry, this message together. And so, God, would you open our minds and our hearts as we look at your word together today. All for your glory, Jesus. Amen. So in this passage, the first thing that we recognize is that God has called us new creations. New creations in Christ. And this, it's interesting, this word new does not just mean something with a fresh coat of paint. It is something that has never existed before. Something so completely different than what had been previous. So if we are in Christ, if we've accepted Christ, we are something different than before. Now, when I married Jill, or when Jill married me, because we know that that's the harder part, it's one of those things, and she grew up in pastor's family, and now my kids are realizing that every single event in our lives become part of sermon illustrations. So let me tell you what happened this week. So Jill and Caleb, they go to school in Trinity in Janesville, and Jill works there, and so they stopped at Dairy Queen, and to avoid passing kids and an extra long truck and some construction, Jill didn't want to hit any of those, so she decided to hit a fence post instead, which I guess is better than hitting kids. So yay for that. So it just kind of, yeah. This is the real story, at least how I heard it. So she calls me and says, Rick, you're going to be mad. And it never starts out well when it goes from there, right? So just picture on the driver's side fender, it's kind of mangled a little bit, some scrapes, some dings, some dents, but it is not just tap it out, had to be fixed. And so I go to the body shop, Dave's body shop, and talk to Scott, and he looks at it and he says, yep, you're going to need a new fender. Oh, and he says, oh, you're also going to need a new liner, and there's some work we're going to have to do, and, you know, we're going to match the paint as best we can, because it's a 9-year-old vehicle now. And I'm like, oh. He goes, don't worry, we'll get a new fender, and it'll look as good as new. This is not what Paul is talking about here at all, right? Paul is not just saying, hey, we're going to take what you were, and we're going to fix it, and we're going to use the exact same as it was, and it'll kind of match, but maybe not quite, because you know what the sun does to paint. God is saying that there's something brand new here. This isn't just something that's fixed or repaired. And so Paul, I'm sure, had in mind Isaiah, that God had said to Isaiah 700 years before Christ. He said, forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? See, God had told all the way back in Isaiah that there would come a day when there would be something brand new. And Isaiah could not understand what that was. But now Paul, looking back at Christ and looking at what he did on the cross, he says, I now understand what Jesus was talking about, what God was talking about in Isaiah, and what Jesus lived on this, in this life. Now, if everything is sermon illustration, I got to use a sermon illustration for my life too, because I can't just leave Jill out there. So one of the things that I am really terrible at is when we get something new, getting rid of the old. This is why we have like 8 boxes of board games in our garage, right? Because we get a new one and go, oh, this looks fun. And we don't say, well, I've got to get rid of one in order to take that place. And so some of these board games we have never even played before, but we may someday. So we got to keep them. Now, some of you, I know, are really, really good at that, at saying, if we're going to get something new, something has to go. And this is what God was saying Paul was saying. He's saying, if there's something new that God has brought into us, something old has to go. Something old has to go so something new can come. So what went? Like what was removed? Well, Paul says in this passage that God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their sins or trespasses against them. See, God first, the first thing that God did was he removed the requirement for us to pay our own sin penalty. See, we have this in our mind. Religion teaches us that you have to fix yourself, that you have to do enough good stuff. And if you work hard enough, or if you do the right things, then that's going to fix your own problem. But that's not what Christianity teaches us. It teaches that this is a relationship, that God actually did the work first, that he removed that requirement for us to have to do the work. And this is called expiation. It's a big word that means Jesus paid the price for our sins, removing the requirement to pay the price ourselves. So when we're talking to other people about faith and what Jesus did on the cross, this is one part of the salvation story that says that Jesus paid the price for us. And he removed this concept, this idea that somehow I have to pay my own debt. And so when Jesus died on the cross for our sins, he removed the sin penalty requirement. And not only that, but he also removed all of our shame. He removed all of our guilt. He removed all of our pain. He removed our brokenness. He removed our status as enemies of God. All of that God did for us. And that is good news. This is the gospel, that we are not held to the requirement to pay for our own sins. And so God chose to not hold our sins and our trespasses and our debts against us. That was step one. And that had never been done before. So that right there is something new already. But not only that, he took all of that shame and all of that brokenness and all of those trespasses and all of that, and he removed them so that there could be a place for something new inside of us. And so when we are in Christ, we've called on Christ to be saved, the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of us. See, that had not happened before. That was not part of anything in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit would come on people for a cause, for power, for strength, but not to dwell inside of them. And so now we have the Holy Spirit inside of us living every single day. And that is what is the basis for a new creation in Christ. So you might be asking then, well, if God created us new and he made us new and he put the Holy Spirit inside of us, then why do I still sin? Why is there still a sin nature? And this idea or this concept of a new creation is part of the mystery of salvation. It's part of the already but not yet. See, we have been made new. The moment that we called on Jesus to be saved, he makes us new. And then being made new is a process every day of our life. And so we receive this new, never before been, new nature. It's not just a coat of paint on top of our old nature that God kind of just fixed up a little bit. He put a new nature inside of us. But this old sin nature and this new spirit nature, they're in conflict with each other. The kingdom of this world and the kingdom of God and the attitudes and the things that we do with our time and our money and our energy, they're in battle with one another. And some days the kingdom of this world wins. And there's some days that the kingdom of God, the spirit within us, he wins. But every day it's this conflict inside of us. And we're going to have this battle inside of us every day until the day that we meet Jesus face to face. It's not something that we can avoid. We're never going to become perfect in this life. And if we strive for perfection, and we're going to be disappointed. And so the real evidence of being made new is not spiritual ecstasy, not bliss, not being in the spiritual plane all the time. It's obedience. Was I obedient to the Spirit? Did I live according to the flesh and the fleshly nature? Or did I live according to the spiritual fruits of love and joy and peace? Did I choose to love people even though they were unlovable? Or did I live according to the flesh and treat them the way they deserved? Man, somebody said something to me that was offensive. Did I become offended and hold a grudge? Or did I forgive? And I chose not to be offended. See, this nature, these two natures inside of us, while we are already made new, sometimes we have to make that conscious choice to obey the Spirit and to live according to His ways. And it's not always easy. It's not always easy to walk according to the Spirit. And specifically, as we are thinking about purpose, what is the purpose for my life? Why has God placed me here? How do I live out new life in the midst of a world that is very broken? And how do I even figure out what my purpose is? Jill likes to bring home plants. And it's funny, sometimes these plants have the absolute smallest container possible. I mean, they're basically yogurt cups. Right? And she brings it home and she shows it to me, and she's all concerned about the plant. I'm looking at how small the thing is, and I'm like, they got you to buy a bigger planter, didn't they? Right? But that's what they expect. They expect you to either buy a bigger planter or to put it in a garden. Because what would happen if we left the plant inside that small container? Chances are it'll die. At the very least, that plant will never become fruitful because that's not where it was designed to be. That plant was designed to be in a garden or in a large planter where it can reach the fullness of its purpose. Maybe some of us don't recognize and realize our purpose because we've contained ourselves. We said, well, I don't know what God's purpose is, and so I'm gonna make my purpose very small when God's intention is for us to have a large sphere where we work, where we live, where we go to school, the teams that we're on, the boards that we're on, the nonprofits that we're on, where all of these things, where we have an ability to have a lot of influence in people's lives, sharing the good news of Jesus. Now, it may not always be, let me tell you about Jesus, but it may be to simply live out our transformed lives. And as we live out our transformed lives, it will draw people to say, man, you are so different. Why are you so different than everybody else? You don't complain, you don't gossip, you don't talk bad, you don't post on social media like everything what everybody else does. Like, why? Let me tell you about Jesus. And so living out our new transformed lives lets us understand His purpose. If you're taking notes, here's our first point today, and that is God is reshaping us for Himself. God is reshaping us. In the Old Testament, Jeremiah gives this illustration of a potter. And maybe you have seen this in your own life. You see a master craftsman sit down at that pottery wheel, and he spins the wheel, and he puts this lump of clay on the potter wheel. Now, if it was me, you don't want to see what that piece of clay would become, all right? I remember summer camp, we had pottery time. I made a baseball because that's all I could figure out how to make was a ball, right? And so I thought, oh, I'm going to throw this, and threw it, and you know what happens, right? But here's God in Jeremiah, and a potter will spend time, and he'll shape that piece of clay. And he'll use that piece of clay, and he'll use the purpose for which he's planned, and he'll say, I'm going to make a vase. Or I'm going to make a pitcher. Now, there's nothing that says that, okay, so this master craftsman, he makes plates. So you have to make plates. God, the master craftsman, gets to look at that clay, you and I, and says, what do I want to make this person? What do I want this person's purpose to be? And he shapes that. He shapes you and I to do the things that he has prepared in advance for us to do. And there are times in that lump of clay where there's just a little bit of like an air pocket or a little bit of an imperfection. And that master craftsman works that imperfection out. And at the end of the day, this is the most beautiful piece of pottery. Plates, bowls, cups, pitchers, basins that you've ever seen. And it's because that's what the master craftsman can do. And God does that through us. And he makes us from that lump of clay into something that has never been seen before. The purposes that God has in you are so unique. There is no blueprint that says, I've just got to make 100 million of these. We are all crafted, and the Holy Spirit uses us to perform the purpose that God is reshaping for himself. So what does God want us to do? What does he want you to do? And how does loving where we live like play itself out in sharing this transformed life, this new life? I don't know if you've recognized it or realized it, but this world has been polluted and marred by sin for a very long time. Since the very beginning of time, we have had this sin problem. And so God, in his sovereign and infinite wisdom, marked the day when the Holy Spirit would come and say, this is an opportunity for my people to live new, transformed lives. And so we get to experience the Holy Spirit, this new thing inside of us and inside of the world. And here's the most beautiful part of this, is that God has entrusted to us the message of reconciliation, how to have this new life. That's up to us. Our neighbors and our coworkers and our classmates, the college that we're going to, the school we're going to, no matter where it is, no matter what is happening, like these are opportunities that we can take our minds off of the things of this world and say that God has placed me here for a reason. The message of reconciliation, how to be made right with God. Here's our second point. God is refocusing us for others. If God is reshaping us for himself, making us new creatures in Christ, then he is refocusing us for others. How do we share this good news? How do we love others? We heard from Annie that she didn't think that this neighbor was going to be relevant in her life. And so the name just passed in one ear and out the other. There's many people that we run into that we just immediately say they're not going to be relevant in my life, so I'm just going to just avoid them. Or I'm just not going to remember. I'm not going to invest in them because I'll wait until I have my own house and my own family. Then I'll love where I live. Then I'll invest in others. And God is saying that every single person that God has placed in our path, in our life, is a soul that needs to hear about Christ. Why? Because our souls are forever. Our souls are forever. And we may only have one opportunity And we may not ever be able to share the gospel with every single person, but we can definitely plant seeds. We can definitely be kind. We can definitely maybe water what somebody else has already planted. And so that we can just continue to share the hope of Jesus and what it means to live a transformed life on earth. This is his mission. This is our mission that God has given us, to set our minds on things above. It's so easy to become distracted. It's so easy to just get overwhelmed with all of the stuff that's going on in this world, in our lives. There's a lot. So are you distracted? Are you fixed on the things of earth? Because we have new life, and loving where we live strengthens us to live out our transformed life. So, refocus your life for others. There's a new Mission Impossible movie coming out, believe it or not. And so Mission Impossible is one of those things that is super relevant today. And I know that there was a TV show, Mission Impossible. And so as you're watching Mission Impossible, it starts with the theme song, right? And you kind of got that in your mind, and you watch that fuse, it's lit, and it's moving along. And when the recording comes along, and the voice on the recorder says something like this: your mission, should you choose to accept it. See, we have a mission. We have a mission while we are on this earth, and it's up to us whether we accept this mission or not. But if we want to truly live out God's purpose for us, then it includes living this mission out. Because this is what Paul said, that we are ambassadors for Christ. It's interesting because this term has not changed much from through the generations. In ancient days, an ambassador was a representative of a king that would go to another kingdom and says, we want you to live at peace with us. This is the way that you live at peace with the king of this country. Today, we send out ambassadors to every country in the world, and they speak on behalf of the president of the United States. In kingdom talk, the king of the universe, his kingdom, and he sends out ambassadors to this broken world, this kingdom, and he says, I want you to live at peace with me, and this is how you do it. And we carry the message of how to live at peace with God. And God's already done the hard part. God already removed the requirement for us to pay for our own sins. And so living at peace with God, if you remember from Acts, Luke records and Paul said that God is not far from any one of us. And we bring this message saying that we want people to find God. We want him to want people to seek him. And this is the message, that new life is possible in Christ, and that God does not want anyone to perish, but for all to come to repentance. And so he makes his appeal through us. So this is great news, but it's also very hard news. That if God wants to make his appeal through us, and this is our mission, then it requires us to act. It requires us to say, I am going to take his mission and his message seriously. And so God is refunctioning us for his message. This is what is new, is the Holy Spirit transforms us. And then we get to say, I don't want to be who I used to be. And I want you to know what it means to have new life as well. And so who has God put in your life? Who have you been building a relationship with? Who maybe do you need to start building a relationship with? Who has God been making ready to hear the message of the gospel? Is it time for you to be God's messenger? Because you are new. Never been seen before, never experienced. The Holy Spirit inside of you is new. And here is the best part of all of this. This is not something that you have to do alone. This is something that God has given to us. Because the Holy Spirit unites us as brothers and sisters into one family. And we get to carry the message and the ministry of reconciliation together. And so, as we go out and share the hope of Jesus with others, the new life, this transformed life, we do it with joy. We're going to close our service by singing together. So if you would stand with us, celebrating new life in Christ together. Everything's new, and we can live out this new life, even though the world just seems so old, so broken. So God, as we go out these doors, Lord, we do thank you for the holiday weekend, for what we celebrate as the day we recognize those who gave their lives the ultimate price. Lord, we are so thankful and grateful. We're thankful for these opportunities that we may have even just this weekend to take what we've learned, to take action because we're going to get together with neighbors or other people. And Lord, would you give us boldness and courage to live out our transformed lives? Would you strengthen us so we can live this out and so others will know that you are for them and you love them? Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice on the cross, your death, your burial, your resurrection, your coming again, Lord, that unites us as your family. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you for worshiping with us. Have a great week.